Good evening and welcome. I'm Jillian Kumagai, and I'm the manager of the Stanford Health Library. It's my pleasure to welcome you to our talk tonight, Staying Independent and Free from Falls. This talk is part of our Living Better series, which has been a great success and is the brainchild of one of tonight's speakers, Dr. Randall Stafford. We're also very fortunate to be hearing from Ellen Corman, Manager of Injury Prevention and Community Engagement from Stanford's Trauma Service. Throughout the talk, please enter any questions in the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen, and at the end of the talk, the speakers will answer as many of those questions as possible. Dr. Stafford, I'll turn the screen over to you.
Great. Thank you so much, Jillian. Well, it's great to have you here this evening for the next installment of our Living Better series. This series was created to try to empower patients to take control of their chronic disease conditions. And while tonight we're talking about falls and how to prevent falls, other sections of this series have focused on a number of chronic diseases, such as high blood pressure, diabetes, heart disease, heart failure, and kidney disease. So it's great to have a slightly different focus today as we focus on falls prevention. The goal of this series is really to make patients and their family members more aware of the ins and outs of how the healthcare system works and how you can get the most out of your medical care. And that applies not only to tonight's talk about falls and falls prevention, but really any chronic disease or any disease situation or health situation that people face. Tonight, the focus on preventing falls is a logical outcome of this series and really trying to identify those areas where people need help, where the healthcare system sometimes provides some very pivotal help, but also instances in which the healthcare system really fails to serve patients in the best way. And my belief is that in these situations, patients and their family members need to take control. So I'm going to go ahead and share my first slide here. But before doing that, I wanted to introduce myself and have Ellen Corman, my co-leader tonight, introduce herself. So I am a professor of medicine in the internal medicine department at Stanford University. And my focus has largely been on research in the area of prevention. I study things like obesity, diabetes, high blood pressure, and heart disease, and how both patients and their doctors can do better at both treating and preventing these conditions. I continue to practice clinical care one day a week within the Stanford Internal Medicine Clinic. And I come here largely with the perspective of a primary care physician who does research. And with that, I'd like to have Ellen introduce herself as well, and then we'll get to the heart of the conversation tonight.
Thanks, Dr. Stafford. My name is Ellen Corman, and I am really pleased to be here today. I am the manager of injury prevention and community engagement in our trauma service here at Stanford Healthcare. I'm an occupational therapist with a master's in rehabilitation administration. And trauma centers are the place where we go if we have a situation where you may need emergent medical care, maybe taking you into surgery. We see lots of car crashes and bike crashes, but we also see a lot of older adult falls. So that's why we are very interested in being able to talk with the community, and because what we know is that falls are not an inevitable part of aging. The falls can be prevented and certainly can be reduced. So I'm really happy to be here today to be able to talk with you more about that.
Thank you for joining me, Ellen. And just to let you know, although we're going to have some material at the beginning that covers some of the science of falls, we hope to make this session very interactive. And I'd encourage all of you to submit questions to the Q&A, and anything goes. Between the two of us, we'll try to take on those questions that you ask. And if we don't know, we'll seek some advice elsewhere and get the answers back to you. So I'd like to go ahead and share my screen here. This talk is on preventing falls, particularly in older adults, although I should point out that other groups may be prone to fall even before they reach older age. As full disclosure, I want to say that I serve as a scientific advisor for a company called Age Bold. And this company develops online programming in part to help prevent falls in older adults. So before we go any further, I wanted to take a couple minutes to have the audience members fill out a poll. This poll will give us some sense of who's in the audience and what questions may be at the top of your list. So we're going to give you just a short amount of time to go ahead and finish this poll. I'm going to do it myself right now. And let's see here. And I'd encourage you all to put in your vote for these two questions. We're looking at, you know, how often it has been that you've fallen, and also interested in the age of those who are here, concerned about their own falling, as well as whether we have any healthcare providers or family members in the audience. And make sure you scroll down on that poll, because I noticed that the last response for those people who are caretakers to someone who's concerned about fall was just at the bottom of the list. So again, we'll give you just a couple minutes to obtain your responses to these questions. Okay, let's finish up the polling. If we can go ahead and do that, that would be great. And I think I'll go back to the slideshow now. And again, I'm only going to present a few slides and go through these relatively quickly. But we now have some poll results up, and you know, we can see that there are a fair number of people who have had no falls, but also a number that are reporting injurious falls where they needed to see a healthcare provider, and that's happened among 19% of the audience members. We can also see that by and large, the audience is composed of people in their 60s, 70s, and 80s, and perhaps above, who are concerned about their own risk of falling. So thank you so much for giving us that insight about who's in the audience. And we look forward to addressing your specific issues as we go along tonight. So first of all, I want to let you know that falls are incredibly common, and perhaps a much bigger problem than you might think, reading from the news media, or even based on what your doctor talks about with you in the office. But it's known that somewhere around a third of adults 65 and older fall at least once every year. And that as people age, the likelihood of falling increases as well. So once people are up in the 85 year group, there's almost a 50% chance of having a fall each year. And some people fall more than once, of course. It's also known that 20 to 30% of falls result in an injury. And although the types of injuries that occur from falling are often very treatable, nonetheless, those falls often initiate a process of decline that some people just don't come out of. And I'm sure you are all familiar with stories of people who, let's say, fracture a hip, and perhaps they get that hip replaced or repaired, but somehow they find it difficult to get back to where they were prior to the fall. So this is a common story. And I think one of the things that, as a primary care physician, I'm very intent on trying to keep people from falling in the first place. As you can see over on the right-hand side of the screen, this is an enormous cost to our healthcare system. We have here current information through 2020, but then projected information showing that the cost of falls in terms of medical costs will double between now and 2030 and will be in the range of $100 billion each year. That's a huge toll for something that just simply isn't talked about as much as it should be. In terms of strategies, I'm going to leave most of this to Ellen, but the fact is that there are many strategies that are available, many underutilized, that help people with reducing the risk of falling, or at least reducing the risk of injury-causing falls. These include things like exercise and physical activity training, the assessment and modification in the home to prevent fall risks. And then assessment of vision is extremely important and something, again, that doesn't always happen as it should in primary care. And then finally, medications are a major contributor to falls, as are things like alcohol use or the use of medications for sleep. And those strategies have been tried, and I'm sure Ellen will talk about this more. Strategies really work best when things are bundled together. A strategy that focuses just on physical activity is not going to be as successful as one that kind of looks at the whole person or the whole household and tries to intervene in that way. There are a number of physical activity training programs that have been developed. These have been very successful. And yet the truth is that there are lots of barriers to wider implementation of a number of different strategies for falls prevention. These include the cost of some of these interventions, the accessibility of interventions, particularly for a population that in large part is homebound. There may be stigma associated with participating in a program to help prevent falls. There may be a lack of compelling content, particularly in programs that are local and which may not have the depth of some of these nationally tested programs. I hate to say it, but particularly for primary care, there really is a lack of provider knowledge and training about falls. And then finally, the fragmentation and lack of coordination in terms of both healthcare and other social services for older adults really leaves a lot to be desired. And my belief is that this also contributes to that, that issue of how poorly we do in managing fall risk. And then finally, from the viewpoint of the population, some of these strategies are really very effective, but hard to maintain over a long period of time. So coming up with new strategies, new ways of engaging people, particularly within their homes, is going to be very important in the future. And I think all of these things are magnified even more by the COVID-19 pandemic, which has reduced people's ability to get outside the house, which has made a lot of older people feel homebound, and we need to find solutions here. I did want to just mention something I had meant to touch on earlier, which is this issue of why people fall. So many people think about falls almost as a natural part of aging. If you get old, you're going to fall. Well, the statistics, from a purely statistical point of view, that's true. But I would argue that there are many risk factors for falling, which can be related to aging, but aren't necessarily related to aging. So for instance, as our bodies age, we're going to have a problem maintaining our muscle mass. Muscle is going to be selectively replaced by fat tissue, leaving us with less strength. At the same time, issues of balance and sensory input from our extremities, this sense called proprioception, being able to tell where our body is in space, deteriorates over time. Some of these changes are not necessarily part and parcel with aging. They happen because of health behaviors that set people up for these problems. So although there's some sense of inevitability with aging and falls, there are many things that can be done to short circuit that correlation. So with that, I'm going to turn things over to Ellen.
Thanks, Dr. Stafford. I'm Ellen Corman with the Trauma Service at Stanford Healthcare. Let's see if we can't. Uh-oh, it's not moving. Oh, here we go. Okay. So I'm going to talk a little bit about what causes falls as well, and then what we can do about them. And Dr. Stafford just mentioned that that falls are caused by multiple issues. It's not just one thing that can cause a fall. So what we know is that it is multifaceted. So because it could be for many reasons, then we have to have multiple approaches. Let's say somebody is walking down the street and trips on a crack in the sidewalk. Is that trip on the crack of the sidewalk an environmental problem? There was a crack in the sidewalk, it shouldn't have been there. Or could it have been that their vision isn't as good and there's a lot of glare, so they didn't see it, so they didn't prepare for it? Or could it be that they had had medications that made them a little bit more groggy? Or could it be that they don't have the heel-toe ability to walk with their heel? When you walk heel-toe, then your toe rises above little cracks. But if we didn't walk heel-toe, we were walking more flat-footed. And then we went to go trip, but because we're not as strong as we used to be, we couldn't keep ourselves from falling when we tripped, then maybe there are many reasons that contributed to that fall. It wasn't just that crack in the sidewalk. So we really do need to look at why a variety of reasons why we may have fallen. Besides exercise, medication, and home modifications, health factors, the behaviors that we have, our vision, even hydration, and certainly the consumption of alcohol can all contribute to our risk for falling. So what do we do to reduce those falls? We can start talk about exercising. We need to talk to our doctor, adopt healthy behaviors, and look at our home for safety. And I'm going to go through each one of them. So let's talk about exercise. We know that lack of strength and balance contributes to the risk for falling. And Dr. Stafford mentioned that, yes, as we age, we do lose some muscle mass. We do get weaker. But what we also know is that our lifestyle contributes to more sedentary lifestyle as we age. I think about as I'm aging, that when I was younger and took care of a family with children, I was doing lots of laundry and bending over and picking things up and reaching for things. I still work. When I go over to the hospital, I park one place and I have to walk a good many blocks to get into the hospital to go to that office. And I don't call that exercise. I call that going to work. But it means that I'm moving more. So as we move, as we stop having those reasons to move as much, we get weaker. And so what we need to be able to do is figure out how do we add activity to our life to keep up that strength and balance, especially as our aging body is going to lose some of it naturally. So we have to do even more to make sure that we're keeping that up. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about that in a minute. What else can we do? We can talk to our doctor about fall. I know sometimes people are a little bit hesitant to talk to the doctor for fear of being able to be to lose their independence. But actually, your doctor should be your ally. We know medications contribute to fall risk. So if your doctor doesn't know that perhaps sometimes you're feeling lightheaded or dizzy, then they won't know that they need to look at it and consider changing things. Sometimes our blood pressure contributes to fall risk. Even if you think of yourself having high blood pressure, if you're now on medication to reduce that blood pressure, the high blood pressure, it can contribute to low blood pressure, which can contribute to lightheadedness and falling. Doctors can check your vitamin D, which is extremely important in preventing falls. We're finding more and more data that talks about that. perhaps your strength and balance and your gait would benefit by you working together with an occupational or a physical therapist. And the doctor would be the one who could make that referral for you. The physical therapist for gait and balance. The occupational therapist might be able to help you with your home safety assessment or helping you with your activities of daily living. So remember, your doctor can really be your ally. And then remember that behaviors can contribute to fall risk. Have your eyes checked. If your vision is compromised, then that could be contributing to balance issues, as well as your ability to see in front of you. If you're walking forward and there is something on the ground and you see what's on the ground, then you could step over what you see or you could walk around it. But if you don't see it, you can't avoid it. And if you can't avoid it, then you could trip on it. So having your vision is not only important for you to appreciate your surroundings, but it's important in the fall prevention picture. You want to have well-fitted and secure shoes. That means shoes that have a good, that have a back to it. I'm a flip-flop. I used to love wearing what I call flip-flops, right? But anything your foot can slip into, it can slip out of. And then that creates a risk for falling. You want to be able to make sure that the soles aren't so thick that you can't feel the ground. So you want them to have good tread, you want them to be good fitting, and you want them to stay on your feet. Another is to limit alcohol use. Our aging bodies actually, and Dr. Stafford can answer this more if any of you have any questions, our aging bodies process the alcohol differently than you're more like the teen. And so what you could consume at the age of 40 may have a different effect when you're 75. The same amount of alcohol is consumed differently for you, and therefore that can create more problems for you. And then reach out to to family and friends for help when you need it. Are you putting up a Christmas tree this year? Is it best for you to be able to try to put the star at the top of the tree, or would there be a family member who might be able to do that for you? And then of course, home safety and modifications. We know that about 50 to 55% of falls happen at home. We can't control everything that's going on in the community, the cracks in the sidewalk, the burrs from the trees that are coming down there, your friend's house, the church that has a rug that might have gotten in your way. We can't control that. But we spend more time in our home, especially since COVID, than ever. And so what we need to be able to do is control those spaces. Since more than half of falls are happening at home, then we want to make sure that those spaces in home are safe environments. And that can include going from room to room and really being able to look at your home to make sure it's a safe environment. CDC has, if you go to cdc.gov, has some wonderful resources and has a great home safety checklist if you want to be able to go through your room by room to be able to take a look. Oops. So I'm going to go back to exercises because I'd love for you to, if you would, put in the chat whether you are doing any exercising right now, and if so, what you're doing. When I speak to groups, most of what I hear is people walk. And I'm a walker too. I love to walk. But walking is good for your strength. It's great for your cardiovascular system. It's great to clear your head. But it doesn't work on your balance system. And it doesn't even work on your flexibility. So keep on walking. But look at what else you're doing in order to be able to work on your balance and flexibility. A couple exercises that I have here are really easy to do. The first one is ankle circles. And that would just be lifting up your foot and drawing a circle with your ankle. And if you do it for 10 times in one direction, 10 times in the other direction, and change feet and do it the other direction, doing those ankle circles means that you can have strong and flexible ankles. Your ankle is your balance joint. If you're walking and you go to be able to and stand on a burr that fell from the tree and you don't have the flexibility, then your ankle can that whole thing can topple you over. Even going from grass to sidewalk, you'll feel it more. And walking that heel toe that I mentioned, you'll be able to walk a heel toe easier if your ankles have that kind of flexibility and strength. The second exercise is a sit to stand. This is one of the few exercises that almost any physical therapist you'll ever come in contact with will tell you is the best thing to do. And it's because it actually works on strength and balance in one exercise. So take when you're on a sturdy chair, not one with wheels like I'm sitting on right now, but on a sturdy chair, the best thing to do is to move yourself about halfway up on the chair. If you have the strength to stand up without holding on, then cross your arms across your chest and go from sitting to standing slowly. And then don't plop down, sit back slowly. That builds strength, that builds balance. What happens if you can't do that? Well, then if you have an arm with a chair with arms, hold on to the arms. But watch as you do it. If you're putting all your strength on your arms, then you're not working the legs muscles and you're not working on your balance as much as you need to. So start with those armrests, but see if over time you can put less and less of your body weight on there. If you don't have a chair with arms, sit in front of a sturdy table and hold on to the table. You could even do it with a sturdy locked walker, but make sure you have something that's very sturdy if you're using that to hold you up. And then remember, the more you have to use that other thing to pull you up, that means that you do not have the strength and the balance to do it by yourself. If you are walking around and holding onto furniture in your home, we call that furniture walking. That tells me that your strength and balance isn't as strong as it needs to be. If you are always holding on to somebody's hand to be able to help you up and down a curb, go for it and do it in order to be safe. But think about what that's telling you. It's telling you that maybe your strength and balance isn't strong enough for you right now, and that working on it could make a difference. There was a study done in Boston, gosh, I think it's been about 15 years ago, with 88 to 92-year-old men and women in an assisted living situation. And they tested all of them, and then they put them on an exercise program. And 100% of them showed improvement in strength and balance with regular exercise. So it's never too late to get started. So let's talk about resources for exercise and fall prevention. Stanford Healthcare has some more programs than most across the country. You're lucky that you live right here. A Matter of Balance is an evidence-based program that looks at being able to talk about fear of falling, as well as to decrease falls. We have a Matter of Balance programs going on right now. And I can get, when you look at the end slide and it gives you my contact information, you can call me about any of those. There's another program called Bingo Size. Bingo Size we just brought to Stanford in the fall. It is so much fun. We have a full class going on right now virtually and another class that starts next week that actually still has room. It's Bingo plus exercise equals bingo size. So we do it virtually. You're at home, you have a bingo card that we give you, and you play some bingo. But in between our calling of our numbers, you stand up and we do exercises together. We in between another call, we might ask or talk about a fall prevention fact. So it's breaking up the game of bingo and learning some great facts, playing some, doing some exercises. You can even win prizes. So if you're interested, Bingo Size still has a few slots. Feel free to give me a call. Farewell to Falls is a program I'm very proud of because I developed this thing back in 2005. It's where an occupational therapist will come out to your home to look at your strength and balance and home safety. A pharmacist reviews your medications. We look at your shoes. We look at all the different things that contribute to fall risk. We only see people in Santa Clara or San Mateo counties. So we don't go to the East Bay or San Francisco. We do have to, you have to be cognitively able to fully participate, and you have to be ambulatory. We know that people who are in wheelchairs fall and need some help, but our program doesn't have the interventions that will work for it. Dr. Stafford mentioned one of the evidence-based programs, Otago, before, and we use those Otago exercises in our Farewell to Falls program, evidence-based exercises that help us with our strength and balance. Another program that's wonderful is called Stay Active and Independent for Life, or SAIL. And SAIL is actually now being offered at a few of our senior centers. They're offered virtually, so Sunnyvale Senior Center has been offering it. And even if you don't live in Sunnyvale, because it's virtual, you may be able to take advantage of it living in another city. So feel free to call them. I believe the San Jose Senior Centers are doing it too. And then the last thing I have down there is senior centers, because our senior centers are great resources for us. They often offer Tai Chi, and they offer, which is the number one exercise that's been researched to show that it helps to reduce falls for older adults. But all kinds of exercises are fun. There's dance, there's Zumba, there's all kinds of fun things. And basically we just need to be moving. And so if you're going to not want to move by doing one type of exercise class, but another one gets you excited and going, then do that one. If you like Tai Chi, do it. If you say Tai Chi is boring or I don't like it, then don't try Tai Chi. Move on to the next one. There's got to be something out there, we hope, that you'll find that's good enough and fun enough for you to keep on doing. And then resources for home safety and modifications. I can't say often enough that falls occur more than 50% in our own home. So go through your home and figure out what can you do to help reduce those falls. Would a grab bar in the bathroom and the shower help you? Are you having trouble getting off out into the garage because of that step? And would some bar help you there to hold on to? Where else in the house could you use some help? So a home safety assessment is a great way to get started. Sometimes it's as easy as getting a handyman and going to your local hardware store and putting something in. But perhaps that's not what you can do. There's some other great resources. Rebuilding Together is a nonprofit organization that you have to own your own home and be considered low income. But if you own your own home and are low income, Rebuilding Together can do the work in your home for you to be able to do some home repairs. If you have the financial means to be able to do some things and would not qualify for Rebuilding Together, there's a company called Home Safety Services. And I don't often try to sell just one profit company, but Home Safety Services is all by itself. I don't know of any other companies in our area that have people who are aging in place specialists who can assess your home and who have licensed and bonded contractors and all the equipment like ramps, like grab bars, like commodes, like all the things that might be helpful for you. They have that for you and will come out in their van and assess and be able to do that work for you. So you can do it yourself or with a handyman. You can call Rebuilding Together. You can call Home Safety Services, but just do something. And sometimes it doesn't take any kind of construction at all. Maybe it just took making sure that the rug can secure to your floor or can be picked up altogether. Maybe you just needed to put a bath mat in the shower so you don't slip there. So sometimes it could require some handyman work. Sometimes it's just something you can do on your own. So I want to thank you for taking the time to be able to listen to me. This is my contact information. I am the person whose number is on the bottom of here, which will also be on the Farewell to Falls brochures, our Bingo Size and Matter of Balance flyers and everything else. So don't hesitate to give me a call or email me for me to be able to give you more information specifically about those programs. Thank you.
That was really great, Ellen. I really appreciated the practical kind aspects of that in terms of how people can actually approach some of these issues. One question that I have, and this is something that I've struggled with a little bit, you know, we talk about how these multi-interventional kind of programs have the biggest impact, where you get people to change multiple things at the same time. But I know as a primary care physician and knowing a lot about health behavior, sometimes that's really overwhelming for people. And often people do better with picking out one single thing they can work on at a time, or at least work on it until they gain some mastery, and then go on to another type of approach or another type of health behavior. So the question is, if you had to prioritize how things work and what would give you the biggest impact, what would be the one thing you would start with? And I'll answer this question myself, which is, you know, as a primary care physician, I know that physical activity has numerous benefits, well beyond just helping to prevent falls. So often that's where I start with, is to talk about physical activity and particularly view it in a very broad way, including your example of walking from your parked car to work. So a lot of what's most useful are some types of movement that we don't even think about as exercise. And sometimes we term these incidental physical activity. So that's often where I start, because it's sort of what I'm trained to do, and I know of the enormous benefits of physical activity. But what's your answer to that question? What's the easiest and most impactful way to start out if you want to reduce your risks of falling?
That's a really tough one, and it does really depend a lot on each individual. That's why assessment is so important. But I read all the research, and we do know that the one thing that stands alone more than anything is the physical activity. It is the exercise. It is the movement. So if you are strong and work on that strength and balance, then that barrier that you had to walk around isn't as much of an issue is if you're weak. If you're lightheaded and dizzy from medications, but you're strong and able to be able to withstand a lot, then that the lightheaded and dizziness from the medications won't have as much of an impact on you as if you're weaker. So strength and balance to me is by far the number one thing I would work on. But we don't need to do Jane Fonda's class and put on the old leotards and tights. We don't need to be able to do things that are crazy. The things that you need to do is say, where are you right now? And what can you do that would be just a little bit more? People who have pedometers. People say that if you walk 10,000 steps, that's what you're supposed to do. But if right now you measured and you walk 1,500 steps in a day, your goal isn't to walk 10,000 steps. If you walk 1,500 steps in a day, then your goal is to look every week at being able to just go up maybe 150 steps. So maybe it's 1,500 steps this week. Maybe next week you can do 1,650. And maybe by a few weeks, you can be up to 2,000. So start where you're at. Figure out what it is that you can do, or start doing those ankle circles. We're talking about doing something that is where you're at. It doesn't need to, even if you're really, really busy, if you're standing in the grocery line and you hold on to your shopping cart while you're waiting in line and you stand up on your toes and hold it and then put your foot down and then do it again, you're working on ankle strength. There's all kinds of ways to be moved without it taking a lot of time, a lot of energy, or a lot of skill.
I couldn't agree more. And I think that one of the problems we have in this area is that culturally, we tend to think about exercise as being very intensive aerobic physical activity. But as we age, we really need to diversify in some sense the type of movement we have. Yes, aerobic activity like walking or bicycling or swimming are very important, but we also have to add in activities which challenge our balance and help us retain our balance. We also need strength training to offset this process of muscle being replaced by fat. And then, finally, I think it's really important to recognize that we're all, if we don't move, we have a potential to lose the ability to do things we really want to do. And flexibility is a really important part of that. So in addition to what we might call aerobic physical activity, where the heart rate is elevated, we really also stress balance, strength, and flexibility. And I think in some ways, using the term exercise doesn't help us very much, because there are a lot of other things that we don't consider exercise, which are very valuable, including things like dancing or gardening. Some types of housework can be very helpful in terms of giving us the ability to keep doing what we want to do.
Absolutely. I'm looking at some of this Q&A.
Why don't you take a couple?
So there was a question about, is there programs to practice safe falling, and how do you find them? And I've read about them in European countries. I have not seen a program for safe falling at all in the Greater Bay Area. And I think a lot of that reason is that the kung fu type movements, karate and all those other kinds of things, they show you how to fall. And those are things that turn into muscle memory. It's one of those things that your body can do, but it takes a tremendous amount of practice and actually a tremendous amount of strength and balance to even do it, to fall right. So I don't think people are doing too many practicing safe falling, because I don't think it's very successful to teach yourself to fall safely. We know that falling safely would mean that you want to fall on your stronger, bigger muscles. So, in an ideal world, you want to protect your head, because you don't want a head injury, and you want to protect your hips. You don't want to have a hip fracture, but learning how to do it safely is something that I really I have not heard of any programs to be able to teach you to do so. So sorry. So our hope is that you can reduce your risk for falling in the first place. So you won't need that.
Yeah, one variation on that is that when you look at the process of people falling, what really matters most is the ability to withstand a near fall. That is, to have a situation where you could have fallen, but you're able to right yourself. And it's in that situation that we make full use of whatever reserve we have in terms of strength and balance. So, there are some programs that are also really attuned to that idea of how can I prepare my body so that I don't fall, even if some conditions lead in that direction. Ellen brought up a really interesting question about alcohol, and this has become one of my favorite topics to discuss, because I personally, both in terms of my own lifestyle and in terms of the advice I give my primary care patients, I've changed my attitude on this. I am firmly of the belief these days that any alcohol above a minimal level probably carries more harm than benefits. I think we have been fed a certain amount of mythology around benefits of alcohol that were perpetuated in large part by the alcohol industry. So this is an area where, if we look at the most recent data, there really are very few net benefits from alcohol. Yes, alcohol use does raise your HDL or good cholesterol. It may also contribute in other positive ways to lipids and heart disease risk, but those benefits are far outweighed by the harms of alcohol use. So I think for those who are growing older, it's even more of an issue because we lose our ability to metabolize alcohol as quickly as we once did. And we have less reserve in our body's neurologic system to be able to accommodate alcohol. So when we have less reserve in our thinking ability, less reserve in balance, less reserve in our sensory processing of where we are in space, all of these things are a setup for alcohol having a very negative impact on the risk of falling. So, you know, back 30 years ago, I used to say, well, you know, moderate alcohol use is probably good because it has some benefits, even though it has some downsides. I think we now know that relatively low level of alcohol use, like 5 drinks per week, probably has no sizable impact. But above that, we start getting into questions of whether there are more harms than benefits.
Thank you. I think that's helpful. Somebody here asked, is Tai Chi okay for elderly who are, let's say, 75 to 80 years old? And I believe it is. Tai Chi has been tested for all ages of older adults, and it is it's been shown to be okay and better than okay, actually quite successful. Tai Chi can be difficult. It uses your mind as well as your body to be able to remember moves and to do them slowly. And there is a Tai Chi program that I always say call it dumbed it down and took 24 moves of Tai Chi to 8 moves and has been able to be a little bit easier to learn. I took a Tai Chi class and I found it really challenging. It was much, much harder than I had expected. But I think I would enjoy something that was a little bit slower. So there are all kinds of different Tai Chi classes. They have different names for them. And so check out what they are. And also see if you are interested in doing Tai Chi, if you can get in that beginner's class. Because people who have been doing them for a long time just move along, and then coming in from the outside and trying to learn those quickly, you may find to be a little bit frustrating or challenging. So find a group that's just starting with you, and you might find that it is not only beneficial, but a lot of fun.
And I think that advice kind of carries over to a lot of different physical activities that people might wish to initiate or to intensify. I think it's really important to go gradually and to take on new types of physical activity in a way that really makes sense and not to overdo it. You know, overdoing it in people's 20s or 30s, that can be fine and people recover quickly, but that recovery time is extended as we get older. And I think it's really important to have a mindset that we're going to make gradual improvements in our physical fitness, in our flexibility, in our ability to keep balanced. So, you know, don't do it all at once and try to find a situation where you can get some guidance, whether it's through a class or an online program or even through friends. But sometimes, you know, doing it on your own can have its downsides. One question that came up in terms of the home environment. And the audience member is asking, what single big change can we make in our home, and we're in our 80s, to prevent falls? What's the number one priority within the home?
That's one's a tough one. I'm a firm believer in first doing things that are super simple, that you can do without having asking anybody else to come in to do anything. And that is looking around. Do you put a towel on your bathroom floor to step out on, and that's going to slip and slide? Is the rug that was in your bathroom been washed so many times that the non-skid part on the other side is now isn't effective anymore? Is it time for a new rug? Do you have a lot of area rugs around your house because aesthetically they look great, but practically they can cause you to trip on? Those are the kinds of things I would look at first, is the things you can pick up there. The second thing I would look at is a grab bar. Grab bars are so helpful in the bathroom. They should be put into every home, regardless of age. I heard about a gentleman who was in his 40s and went on a business trip, and it went into the shower of his hotel and slipped and ended up with a spinal cord injury. This is not just older adults, but older adults, because where you are, it's harder sometimes to lift our foot up over the tub to get in there. And it's if our balance isn't as good and we go to reach for the soap and we're going to, moving around when our body doesn't move as well, then we lose our balance and we could fall. So having a grab bar there to be secure and safe, to me, is probably one of the first things I would do to make sure that my home is a safe environment.
You know, one of the questions that I often get as a primary care physician is the effect of heart disease medications on the risk of falling. And this is a little bit tricky because we know that intensive control of blood pressure, using more medications to result in a lower blood pressure, is beneficial. And a very large study that I was involved in called SPRINT, or the systolic blood pressure intervention trial, really looked at the benefits of standard blood pressure control versus intensive blood pressure control. And what we found was that more people did have dizziness and falls in the intensive group. But first of all, there were very few extra injurious falls in the intensive control of blood pressure group compared to the regular group. And we also know that the benefits of lower blood pressure are very substantial. And in this particular trial called SPRINT, those with more intensively managed blood pressure were less likely to have a heart attack, less likely to die by a factor of 25%. So that is, the risk of dying or having a heart attack was 25% lower if you had a more intensive blood pressure lowering. Now, that doesn't mean there aren't things you can do. One thing in my experience with that trial was to recognize that a lot of people in the intensive control group were falling in conjunction with drinking alcohol and their use of sleep medications. So it may be that that issue of intensive control blood pressure just makes us focus more on the problems with alcohol and overuse of medications for sleep. Any initial comments on that, Ellen?
I think you answered it well. I know I don't have anything to add.
Okay. Another issue that often comes up is that sometimes the chronic conditions that I'm treating as a primary care physician, if I do a good job, if me and the patient do a good job of better managing those conditions, their risk of falling is less. And a couple of examples. One is diabetes. If I'm helping a patient to control their blood sugar better, quite often that results in having better sensation, having better balance, and being at less risk of falling. Same for knee osteoarthritis. This is degenerative arthritis of the knee, a very common issue in those over the age of 65. If people can do the physical activities that help their arthritis, they're going to be at less risk of falling. So very complex picture. And although it'd be nice just to say, well, we can reduce the risk of falling. Sometimes we have to work indirectly by reducing the risk of other things or of managing other conditions.
Perfect. Wayne had a question about any thoughts on the benefits of swimming. And swimming is a great activity, but it is not weight bearing. So that has its pros and cons. If you want to have a strong bones, weight bearing activity is really important, and swimming won't, and it's not going to help you with the balance part, but it does help you with the strength part. So swimming is a wonderful activity, and I would say keep going. But remember that you're not working on balance. So if there's other things that you can do to think about the balance systems as well, then you'll hit the jackpot.
And I have the same sentiments. You know, I think swimming in itself as a type of aerobic exercise can't be beat in some ways, but you really do need to strengthen the bones and to focus on strength training for the muscles, balance training, and greater retaining flexibility. So I would say swimming is a great activity when combined with other types of training, other types of physical movement.
There was a question about, what happened with it? I saw something about asking about using walking sticks, walking poles. And I don't know if anybody answered that. And I don't know what happened to the question, but if the person is still here, walking poles walking poles are actually for those who sometimes need something like a cane, walking poles can give you that kind of help. Actually, if you have some neuropathy, loss of feeling on the bottom of your feet, then having something that's in your hand that also touches the ground, that can help your sensory system so that you can actually feel safer while you're walking as well. Walking poles are actually also, they actually have classes for our walking poles as a aerobic and healthy activity that you can do. So it can be used as a substitute for something like a cane, or it can be used for a physical activity. Just know that each person is different based on what your physical strength and balance is right now. So for one person, a single point cane may be, somebody may not need anything at all. Somebody else may find that just a cane is enough to give them a little bit of support they need. But another person may find that a full walker is what's necessary in order to be able to really give them the stability they need in order to walk safely. So without being able to see a person, it's hard to know which one is actually the best thing for you.
And I'm a real fan of walking poles. I actually took up the practice of using them after I had visited China and saw how many people use walking poles, both quite athletic young people, as well as older people who are still able to do things that were somewhat surprising. So my own practice in hiking and backpacking is to use poles. And it's very interesting that over the last 5 years, walking poles or trekking poles have almost become obligatory for those people doing long distance backpacking, things like the Pacific Crest Trail. So what started out as kind of an oddity and maybe was stigmatizing in a way, I think has really gone mainstream.
And it's true. I use it when I hike as well.
I would encourage anybody who's out there hiking just to have that little extra buffer of stability through the use of walking sticks. And also, it also provides some upper body workout that one wouldn't otherwise have without the poles.
That's true.
So, so you know, usually, I'm sorry, go ahead, Ellen.
No, go ahead. I was just gonna say, I think we got to 8 o'clock. So Dr. Stafford, we may want to stay on a few more minutes to be able to talk, but I did want to let people know that we appreciate your being here, and that knowing that we said we were going to be an hour session, I didn't want anybody to feel bad or guilty if they have to say goodnight.
Yeah, so we're right at the close of the hour here. I thought that maybe we could continue to answer questions for a couple more minutes. I too want to thank all of the audience members for their participation and the questions you put in. It's been really nice to interact with all of you. I wish that in some ways this is a little more interactive, but appreciate you doing the poll early on in the hour. And for me, this has been really great to be able to talk about some of these things that I think are really important and at the same time, kind of underappreciated. So maybe we'll answer just a couple more questions before we sign off. If you have any last minute questions, get them into the Q&A. And one of the questions that came up earlier was this idea about what kind of shoes are best. And you mentioned, Ellen, the idea of avoiding flip-flops or a type of footwear that doesn't have a back. Any other advice in terms of fit and materials, in terms of finding footwear that can help reduce the risk of falls?
So I don't think we have a prescription for the best kind of shoe. I know that thick athletic shoes or other ones, I think somebody said rubber shoes, can get sort of almost stuck on the carpet. So it doesn't feel safe either. Shoes that are more like the like Keds, or ones that I don't want to say, I use Keds like tissues or Kleenex, right? You know, something that's sort of a thinner sole, but still has not a slippery bottom. So you want to make sure that there's some grip on the bottom, but that it's not so thick that you're tripping on your own shoes. That's what I would recommend. And then we have, there's some great shoes at places. You don't have to have what people used to call old lady or old man shoes. There's some attractive shoes that you can wear, but make sure that they fit your foot, that they, that they tie or strap or some way to really stay on your foot.
And I think that it's very important to recognize that any height of heel actually makes walking more difficult.
Oh, yes.
Risk of falling.
And, thank you. I failed to say that. That was should have been the first thing I said. Thank you for mentioning it.
So I think that's it for the hour. Again, I really appreciate your contribution, Ellen. It's been great to talk with you, and I really enjoyed the dialogue that we've had. And again, I appreciate the sponsorship from the Stanford Health Library. They are a great resource for the community of the Bay Area. And I hope to see some of the audience members back at another installment of our Living Better series. So with that, I will sign off. And I think that Jillian may have a word or two, but thank you so much.
Thank you, Ellen and Dr. Stafford, for sharing this great information, so much practical information, and about what we can do to reduce falls. And this is just such a terrific discussion on a significant topic. And to the audience, thank you for joining us and for the great questions, as was mentioned. And if you'd like additional info or resources, please contact our librarians at healthlibrary@stanfordhealthcare.org. And we hope to see you at our next lecture. Thanks so much, everybody. Good night.
Good night.